Ladies and gents, welcome to an evening with the Bulls here at the Cedar Court, Bradford. Can I just kick off by saying, you know what? Give yourselves a huge, huge round of applause, because the turnout here is absolutely phenomenal. Obviously, with the numbers that are having to stay outside, we didn't expect this sort of turnout, but to be honest, you are the Bradford Bulls, and we should have expected it, shouldn't we? The chairman has put together a special video just to kick off the evening, so if I could ask you all to turn towards the screens. Wasn't that cool? That shows you how much heritage, history, all of that stuff that beds right down into the soil that this club has. And when you look across this room and you got youngins in this room, all the way through to the mature supporter. The mature supporter. It does. It brings a tear to your eye. It makes you really special. And we are a family. We are a community. And I tell you the strength of this family that we have here. There's two special people in this room who got married 7 years today. 7 years today. Today's their anniversary, and they chose to come here rather than go out for a meal. So Phil and Lindsay Rhodes, please come to the stage. Come to the stage and accept a drink on the chairman. And I'm going to sneak a kiss. That's right. Lindsay just said he's lucky because it's just got him out of pain for an expensive meal this evening. No worry. There's a drink on us, guys. Ladies and gentlemen, round of applause. Now, everybody's been given a raffle ticket. Right, yes, everyone's been given a raffle ticket. At the end of the night, we're going to draw it. It's going to be for two places at the Dinner of the Decade, which is a week, 2 weeks on Friday. Dinner of the Decade, where we're celebrating the journey to the 2004 World Club Final. So we're celebrating the 2003 season and the win with the World Club Final, World Club Challenge Final at the John Smith Stadium. I think it was, what was it called then? Gal Farm, was it called Gal Farm then? They've changed it that many times, haven't they? So we'll be doing that. There's loads of the players are going to be there. I just had Leslie on the phone all week because he's just arrived back from New Zealand saying, bro, don't forget me, bro, don't forget me. I said, don't worry, Les, we wouldn't put on a dinner without you, so we have to fly him in from France. He could barely speak English, and now he's speaking that Tongan English French accent of his. Oh, I can't understand. I never could understand a word he said anyway. And I'm sure you'd agree with me. I'm sure you would. Let me just introduce our top table. To my close right, I've got Alf Davies, our commercial director, Danny Potticary, the head chief in charge. We've got Marc Green. To his right, the managing director, Steve Ferres. Then we've got John Hamer, vice chairman of the Bradford Northern and Bulls Plus Players Association. And that fella, who's that fella on the end? There's only one, eh? There's only one. You know what? Wait a minute. I get on there, they show some pictures of me, and I get this. Jimmy gets on there and he's running around the room. The first time you see Leslie and you carry on like that as well. He's not even here. But he will be on the 15th. Of August at the Dinner of the Decade. For you that want to come to that, make sure that you get in quick because they're selling like hotcakes and only just over 2 weeks to go. As we saw on the video, we had a couple of our new recruits, Dan Fleming and Jake Maloney. Where are you guys? Come out the front here. Yeah, again, a loud applause, and they haven't even thrown a ball for Bradford. These guys obviously still have commitments with their own clubs, but they're giving up their time tonight to come along and meet and greet you guys and say hello. So once again, ladies and gents, put your hands together for our two new recruits. You know, there's never a time goes by where I give up the microphone too easy. I'm naturally a shy guy as well. You must have seen that. But I just thought I'd share some of my memories with you, because I remember getting off the plane on the 28th of August, 1994. I remember all the way back there. I remember. Hey, Jimmy, remember that thing that we that everyone used to, and sleep. I remember. Yeah, I was 18 years of age, and I remember thinking to myself, you know, you're excited. I'm 18. You're still a kid. And I come to the north of England, I come to this city called Bradford. So the first thing I wanted to do was go down and check out what's going on downtown. You know, the nightlife, everything, how cool it is down in Bradford city centre. So I headed off down there. You know, 7 o'clock at night, feeling good, and everyone's stopping and they're staring at me. They're looking at me, checking me out. And I'm, you know, I go into town just normal, but as everyone's checking me out, I'm starting to grow with the attention, starting to feel a lot prouder, nice chest pumped up. I'm thinking to myself, man, they love their rugby here. I've not even passed the ball for Bradford. And they already know that I'm already famous. How good is that? And then I realized, well, then I got told actually it was because I was wearing stubby shorts, no shoes, and looking like a hobo. in complete Kiwi fashion, you know, so laid back. Oh, how things have changed. Look, I've even got a pocket kerchief as well, eh? You guys have changed me. 20 years it's taken. I learned the protocol. I did. I learned the protocol. I came to learn, to understand that, you know, simple things. Like, I hope. It means, excuse me. It's not someone clearing their throat. I hope. Laking. You know, have you got train spotters? You know, and they go train spotting. If someone's laking, I thought there was a group of people that went around the Yorkshire moors looking for lakes instead of just playing out with your mate. And mocky fat. You eat that. It's a tub of fat. Hey, then I tried it. And now I eat it. But how did we do that? How did I do that? Well, to be honest, I learned it from you guys. From day one. From day one, as soon as I got here, I remember I went to my first sponsor was the Fire Brigade pub. They were my first sponsor. Taken to the pub, and I got to admit, I got smashed that night. I was taught in New Zealand, never refuse a drink. The amount of drinks that were piled in front of me. I can't remember how I got home, but you guys, you took me into your hearts. You took me into your homes. A lot of you, there's so many friendly faces here that I grew up with. And you made me a part of it. You made me a part of Bradford as a whole. One day you might make him as well. But what that meant to me as a person, I came over here for the rugby and I stayed for the people. It was easy as that. Must have stayed. I married one of his as well. It bedded down. And the thing that I loved, that I played for Bradford Northern. I played for Bradford Northern. And then I became a Bull. And as we saw all of that heritage, we saw all of that history that was put up on there. The club was already here. But then when we became the Bulls, we all built something special. We created it, we built it from the ground up, and it's now a part of us. It's definitely a part of me. And it's something that grows and burns inside of me. And I think that's why we've had the turnout that we have. We've had so many people passionately trying to get into this room. And it's why we're all here and turn out in numbers, because we love this club. So give yourselves another round of applause. I just finished by saying this is our club. We built it. With their direction, we'll build it again. We own it, and it's ours. One of the girls at the back of the room. Time. Okay, so I'll move on quickly. Let's have a chat with that guy that he's come back to the club. He's a Bulls legend. He's a former Man of Steel. He's a Super League winner. He orchestrated the win against the Wigan Warriors. Ladies and gentlemen, Jimmy Lowe's. Thing again. He did this on the weekend. He did. He started singing it and he started taking these steps back. He was going deeper and deeper into the dugouts. Jimmy, kind of popular in these parts.
It's because I don't talk as much as you, Robbie. That's what it is.
Mate, I can fully understand. It's quite a humbling experience, getting that sort of reaction, isn't it?
It's very humbling, yeah. It's good, I like it. We'll see a different reaction when we go to Edinley on Friday night. There'll certainly be no Jimmy there. Thank you. Yeah, it's very humbling, and you know, I was lucky to play in a very, very good team, and you know, for someone so not the most talented, I must say, but certainly played with a heart, and I know Bradford fans appreciate anybody who plays with a heart, and and that's why you're here. You know, you've stuck with the club over the last few years, and you know, I know you'll stick with us for the next few years as well, while we fight back in the Super League.
Jimmy, you've been back in charge now a good month. How have you found your time?
Oh, I've loved it, yeah. I've loved it. You know, I spent a year in rugby union, and, you know, I enjoyed it, but it was never my game. And you know, I was itching to get back into the league, and well, this fantastic opportunity came along, and jumped at the chance, and I've enjoyed it. I really enjoyed working with the lads. You know, they've been through a hell of a lot, as you fans have, and they've been through a hell of a lot, and to stick at it, you know, not turning up getting paid, and you know, turning up some days and players are not there, they've been shifting on it. You know, I think it's... I think it's a massive credit not only to you fans to do that, but to these players here that have been through that last couple of years, and to see them work like they have done over the last few weeks. And you know, a coach is only as good as his team, and they're a fantastic bunch of blokes. And you know, whether it's going to be a tough period over the next few weeks, whether they're stopping or leaving, they'll certainly be a credit to themselves over the next 4 to 5 weeks. So you know, they deserve a massive round of applause. Fully deserved to smash Wigan up the other night as well. I thought they were fantastic. And same on Friday at Leeds.
So how excited are you about the future of the club? Obviously the rest of the remainder of the season, but you're going to get a full pre-season under your belt as well moving forward.
No, I'm really excited. I do enjoy pre-season. particularly as a coach, because you can just blow the whistle nowadays, can't you? So I'm looking forward to it. I'm looking forward to pre-season. I'm looking forward to the challenge that the championship will bring us. And, you know, the team will they'll have a really big dig next year and get us back to the top flight as soon as possible there.
So what exactly is your coaching ethos and what are you hoping to achieve?
I just think everything's based on hard work. You know, you've got flair players, you've got talented players, we've got talented players amongst this group of people. Just let them play rugby as well. You know, I like to see entertaining rugby. But get that foundation of hard work and you can achieve anything with that good combination.
And these guys out here, how important are the supporters to the performance of your team on match day?
And it's massive, absolutely massive. People speak about it being an extra player. When you're actually on the field and the supporters are getting behind you, it is like having an extra player on you, on your side. And like I said before, Bradford Bulls, Bradford Norman, always had a really strong core of rugby supporters and who appreciate players who put 100% in every week. And that's what you guys are. And you know, that long may that continue as well on both fronts.
Ladies and gentlemen, keep it going, Jimmy Lowe's. The next fellow I'm going to get up to speak here will be familiar to a lot of you guys. We played together when I first came over to Bradford. He took me under his wing. For those of you that know him, he was one of my mentors, so you know how I turned out. He's a great bloke. I think the last game we played together was the 1996 Challenge Cup final. Am I right in thinking that? Ladies and gents, please put your hands together for John Hamer. Johnny, you find yourself in the position of vice chairman for the Bradford Bulls Past Players Association. How do you find that? You know, mixing with all the old Bulls and Northern players and all the old players around the game. Full stop.
Oh, it's great. I mean, when I was still playing here at Bradford, I was with some of those what I called legends then: Jeff Gration, Keith Mumby, Jimmy Thompson, and they still tip up. So as a young player, playing amongst them lads, and then to back into my playing career, getting on with the Ex-Players Association, and pleased to be part of that Ex-Players Association, to spread the word of Bradford, past, former, present and future, with other associations, and wave our banner in that Ex-Players Association's Cathedral of Life.
Now, you've been around the Bulls from the playing side, Bulls and Northern from the playing side, for a long time. You've seen a lot of the highs, you've seen a lot of the lows. What are some of your fondest memories?
Well, I think my fondest memory is as a young kid from next town on in Halifax, which were a massive rugby town, to get amongst Bradford and actually sign for this excellent club, historic club, both in name and location. One of my greatest highlights is putting the red, amber and black on for Bradford as a young kid, without question.
And the 1996 Challenge Cup final, walking out there, what was that like for you?
Oh, that were a great sort of finish to my career. Obviously, I saw most of my time with Bradford Northern. I saw out the old with one or two other guys, saw in the new Bradford Bulls era. Pleased to be part of both eras, and that were a great finish for me. The result wasn't great, but playing amongst lads that were there, onwards and upwards, yourself, Jimmy, and many others, just a super finish, although the result wasn't right. But it's a great finish for me in my 12 years at Bradford.
What a game it was. Now, why do you think our club has the... what about our club has the potential to get us back right into the Super League after the 2015 season?
Oh, without doubt. I mean, tonight, look at who's turned up initially. This place is the biggest place in the area, and it's full, and there are people outside that can't get in. Your chairman is building a team around him to take this team back up to where it belongs. When I played on back end of my Bradford days and Jimmy came to join us, then a pack were built around Jimmy Laws as a player then, as backs were built around you as a half then. Were you off the field, behind the scenes, with Jimmy as coach? The future of this club is great because with the club getting built around the chairman, the club players getting built around the coach and the management side of it behind you, the future is great for Bradford, and that bounce back will be there.
Ladies and gentlemen, John Hamer. And what John was trying to say, with the chairman building his team off the field, Jimmy Field controlling the team on the field, and with me, the motor mouth on the mic, we're in good hands. So, it leaves it over to the next gentleman I'm going to invite to the stage. I call him the human hurricane, and that's our chairman, Mr. Marc Green. I'm not going to interview him. I'm going to wind him up and let him go. Oh, there's a spare seat down here.
First of all, I'd like to genuinely, from the bottom of my heart, thank every single one of you for turning out tonight. Again, give yourselves a round of applause, those stood outside. In light of everything you've been through over recent years, I was starting to be a bit concerned. Maybe it was a lynch mob rather than a welcoming party. I'm going to give you a very, very brief overview of me and where I've come from. I'm not going to bore you, although Robbie did say I've got to keep this going till 10 o'clock. I'm 49 years of age. I was born in the East End of London. I come from the wrong side of the tracks. I was born into, for someone of my age, reasonable poverty. We were four kids, mother and father, sleeping in one room. Council estate, went down the wrong track. Best thing that ever happened to me at about 13 years of age, I stole something and my father leathered me like you wouldn't believe. And from that day, I've never touched a single thing that didn't belong to me. But that's where I've come from. So whilst I am now fortunate to stand in the honorary position of custodian of this great club, and that's all I really am, is custodian of it, for as long as I'm fortunate enough to be here, I haven't come from a hand-me-down situation. I've come from, literally, the wife often turns around and says, you can take the boy out the gutter, but they're never the gutter out the boy. So that's me, and that's an overview of where I've come from. I've been in business a number of years, and I got the opportunity, and there's no need to go into how, why, and where, to take over control of this great institution, this great club, with the heritage that comes along with it. And it is great. And when I walked in on day one, because I'm as honest as the day is long, I'll be honest with you, it was solely a business decision. And all I was in it for was the opportunity to turn it into a profitable business. In the 4 months I've been here, with the warmth that you, most of you have... everyone in this room before I get lynched, right? But most of the Bradford supporters, I've seen the odd people on social media that think I'm a bit of an arse, but we'll come back to them, right? With the warmth that you've provided me, given me, the love you've shown me, I'm actually now unarguably red, amber and black. Hands up anyone that actually read the match day programme on Sunday. I'm not going to bother writing anything then. The reason I say that is for those of you who actually read it, and those of you who read my article may have seen that on behalf of my fellow board, I apologise to every single one of you. And the reason I apologise to every single one of you was for the fact that despite our best efforts, and I'm happy to share with you some of those efforts this evening, we were unable to avoid relegation. And for that, we apologise to you. Now, those best efforts have included Mr. Ferres making no less than 100 phone calls a day, every day, to try and secure players to bring them in. But where we were at the time, with regards to the deficit of points that we were given, the relegation staring us down the face, it became very, very difficult to convince any top player to come to us other than for a loan, and hence the reason why we've ended up where we've ended up. However, as that video said, the journey starts here. And I actually believe we are now embarking on a phenomenal journey. There are a lot of good things happening about the club. The biggest and the best is you lot in front of me tonight, and the hundreds of people that couldn't get through the door, and those that turn out at a weekend, who between all of you have had not just 1 year, not just the last 2 years, but probably the last 5 or 6 years, I'll say it like this, of having your knackers kicked in. Right? Undeservedly, and you've still stayed true to the sport, to your club, and to the city. So for that, again, well done. Now, some of the things that we've done since we've been here, for those of you who have had the opportunity to visit, we've relaunched the retail section, which has seen a 300% increase in sales. We have started to invest back into our youth academy, which was decimated. And I see strong, strong intent on this club within the next probably 3 to 5 years to be able to develop a squad of homegrown talent, so challenging for the top echelons of this game. I keep being asked by people, what are we going to do with this and what are we going to do with that and how are we going to do it? And people have said to me that I'm only in it for the parachute payment. And as soon as I've got the parachute payment, there's me down to London, off, see you later, never to be seen again. Well, I'm hoping that you lot will be my flag bearers, standard bearers, and carry this message through to anyone you know that supports the club, one that even don't support the club, that couldn't be here tonight. Okay? Last week, we managed to re-sign Mr. Gaskell. And Mr. Ferguson. Demonstrating my commitment and our commitment to delivering you a full-time, first-class Super League team, even in the Championship. Since then, we've added the two gentlemen that were introduced to you this evening. And now I'm pleased to give you two more. Firstly, Mr. Adam Sidlow has agreed to stay with the club. And secondly, wait for it, a product of our own youth. I've suddenly started talking Kiwi. A product of our own youth. Tom Olberson has decided to stay. Where are you, Tom? Come in. Tom Orbison. Yeah, you're not taking the mic off me. So if anyone still doubts our intention to build a Super League team, even in the Championship, if anyone doubts our intention, I think they need to have a good, hard look at what we're actually doing. So why are we here? Apart from the fact that I wanted the opportunity to stand in front of you, most of you, for the very, very first time. I wanted to tell you my sob story of how I came from Tim Bath and Mangle, which some of you my age have never ever seen, an outside toilet. See, Robbie thought he could do it on his own. And as for the reason why you only got one applause and Jimmy got two, I'll tell you. You were a legend. He was and will be again. For those of you who stood out in the foyer, I hope you're getting all this. I apologise for the fact that you weren't able to get into the room, and I'll be mingling around out there for you to ask questions, as long as they're not too deep. Last couple of things. I've got a heckler. Why are we here? Okay. One thing I've always been tried to live my life by ever since I took that leathering from my father at the age of 13, and I promise you it was a proper leathering, the bruises all up my arm, is I've always promised to be honest, make promises I can keep, and never make a promise I can't. And the one thing I promise you, Bradford, the supporters, the city, is this club will be run under my reign with honesty, integrity, and transparency. Now, I dare say some of you would sit there thinking, oh, we've heard all this crap before. But I've only been in it 4 months, and I'd like to think I've demonstrated that so far, and give me more time and I'll demonstrate it further. What do we need to achieve? The most important thing for this club, and some of you may want to lynch me after what I'm going to say next, the most important thing for this club is not actually what goes on the field. What goes on the field is a byproduct of a business that is run properly, soundly, commercially, and that horrible word that some people don't like, for profit. Because if a business is run that way, if this club is run that way, then the byproduct will be a successful team delivering top-class success on the field. That's the only way longevity can be achieved. Now I'm going to bring up a other shaped ball and a team from the other side of the Pennines. But if we can achieve what they achieved in our sport, I think everybody here will be over the moon. Manchester United had 27 years of unbridled success. They didn't do the peaks and troughs that happens in normal sport with a team that's built of good quality players that stay together until they retire, and then all of a sudden there's a cataclysmic gap with no one to fill it. What they did is they built a steady climb and then reached a summit, and every year for best part of 27 years they brought player in after player through their own youth development and had consistent and maintained success. And that is what we intend on delivering for you here for this club. Now, regrettably, and I'm going to jump back a bit because I forgot to mention this. Regrettably, some of the players that we've had this year who have put their bodies on their line, game in, game out, who have been through the trauma that they've been through, Regrettably, some of those will be moving on to pastures new. And I want to thank them. I'm hoping you'll join me in thanking them for what they've given to the club, for putting their body on the line, and wish them all the best in wherever their future takes. Forward again. So, back to the point at hand. I'm going to run this club as a business, and to run it as a business, we're going to have various commercial things that some of you will buy into and some of you won't. Some of you think, oh, that old chestnut, not doing that one. And some of you think, bloody hell, that's innovative. Right? So tonight, we're launching, or relaunching, what was the best, the biggest lottery of any club in the game, I believe, in the history of the game. The big one. It's back. That didn't get a lot of applause, Alf. That was should I quit now?
Right, it's Danny's idea.
I'm going to pass the mic over to somebody in a future, in the second, who's going to talk you through what it's all about, how it works, and what it's going to deliver. But let me tell you where the big one's going to go. The profit that is made from the big one, which was only a few years ago delivering a considerable amount of money to the youth development of this club, that enabled the youth to come through, that enabled people like this man here to be funded when he was but a mere fledgling. It was decimated, and we're looking to rebuild it, and we can only do it with you. And I'm going to leave you with this final sobering thought. You've all heard the terminology, there's no such thing as I in team, right? There's no I in team, you've all heard that before. But let me tell you what, there are two I's in winning, okay? Now, if every one of us comes together as a team, then I and every one of you as individuals become winners as a result of that teamwork. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, our chairman, Marc Green. And so the next person I'm going to introduce to the stage, he's considered to be the guru of all sports club community fundraisers. It is that man. For some of you, you've seen him before. So that's why we're saying we're going back to what we really know and rebuild this club from the ground up with some really, truly strong foundations. Please, welcome to the stage, Alf Davies.
I don't know what I'm left to say now, because I think I had something to do with the chairman's speech, because he certainly took a few of my lines. I've never ever heard him speak of echelons, except in a little note I sent to him. He's used it twice since. Anyway, you probably noticed one major change. The stars speak from that side. They send the boring bit to this side. I can tell you, I was sat at home a few weeks ago, enjoying retirement, because I've not worked for two years now. My last work was at Wakefield Trinity. I've had over 40 years in this game. I'll get a bigger boo than that in a minute. Because I did cut my teeth with Lee Rugby League Club. And after 15 years with Bolton Wanderers, wait for it. Headingley. I love saying that when I come here. You know, one of the first of these functions I ever did was at St. Helens. And some clever bugger decided to mention that he's a Wiganer. Well, I can tell you, the evening was packed, they always are. The talk was good, but they started heckling, and one or two people said, he's a bloody Wiganer, get him. And Ray French came to my rescue, and a player who some of you remember, John Mantle, because I said, well, It's no skin off my nose, but I sincerely hope that when Wigan do get you next, they stuff you. Well, the balloon was up. So what we were looking to sell on the night achieved just four. But with the perseverance of the guy who had to pick the pieces up, he got it up to a very successful level, which I'm sure you will do with this. My job, I've visited lots of clubs in football, rugby, cricket, whatever, speedway, for years. Usually, not always, visiting clubs that had it on hard times. They needed money. Usually, the directors had spent badly. They'd invested in players, it had gone wrong, they'd been relegated, the wages stayed up there, the attendances went down there. Problem. What do? We come back to the people who we've let down and said, will you help us? There's a very similar thread running through this. I've been horrified. I mean, I can speak a little bit more than Mark on this. 16,000 people at the end of December 2006 were registered on the Bulls lottery. A few of the ladies are here now, Pat and Jane and Denise were here there. Jeanette came a little later. It's no coincidence that at that time this club were winning trophies and was considered to be the leading club in Super League. But what happens then? Egos take over. Chairman, turn this way. They ignore you. Marc Green has done a wonderful job in lifting this club and getting it back. One of the things that I had to be sure of when Steve Ferres, my great friend, and a bloody good one, asked me to come and meet with Mark and Danny to discuss doing a little bit and helping with planning the strategy for the club. I had to be sure, for my own personal peace of mind, that I wasn't going to get with another, I could swear, but there are kids in, person or persons that you lot have had to put up with for the past 6 years. I kid you not, I would not have come here if Marc Green had said, if we get relegated, I'm off. I can't go into too much detail. I'd love to, by God, wouldn't I? And I might do one day. But what those people did to this club, I'll name one of them. This particular person, I only found out this week, I think it's atrocious. Female members of the staff were addressed by the chairman as, girl, here now. Lady, here now. Thank you. I'll not repeat it. I know what I'd like to do him. I'd like to stick his curry where, whatever. I do get passionate on this because it sickens me when I see what has happened to a great club. And for somebody who worked at Leeds to say that, you know, I can go back a little bit to where we are now, and I hear rugby league say, what's wrong with the game? Why aren't people coming? We need to do this. They'll let somebody loose and start meddling with the obstruction laws. Now, I'm not one that these lads will tell me that. And they've come up with this idea, and that'll improve it. You know what? I've flogged this for years. If the rugby league would only get off the backside, get Nigel this way, look at what can fill a room, and ask them what they want for the game. Now, I'm going to calm down now because I've got a decibel counter here that says The row of them was bigger than the one for Robbie Paul. Now, for an old bugger like me, it's a privilege to come back and meet people I've seen on many occasions here at the Bulls. And if I give you an example of ignoring people, I'll take you back to an incident at this club, probably about 2006. Jane, you might tell me different. The appointed chief executive, very nice man, Gareth Davies, from marketing director, I think, of Reebok UK. And it coincided his first day. We were doing a corporate sales meeting, launch over in the Coral Stand, still playing this current season, but we're selling next season. So the theme there being, the Bulls are ready for next season now, while you lot elsewhere are thinking about it. We were hugely successful. He called me at the end of the night. He said, "Alf, I've never seen selling like that before. Will you come in and have a chat with me?" I said, "Certainly I would." So I called in a couple of days later. "Go on, explain yourself." He said, "Well, you were talking to people and selling in the face." I said, "What do you mean? Where would you sell?" "Email." I rest my case. Yes, he would call me a crusty old bugger, this one here, because I don't embrace modern technology. But yes, social media, is that the right term? Is important, but nothing can ever, as I alluded to earlier with the rugby league coming looking, can beat talking to people and saying, "Are you with us next season? Let's go, let's show them." There is another great difference between myself and the special one. And I warned him this. I said, "You know, Mark, you've got to convince the people, and it will take time, because yes, they've been treated badly. And the other thing that you have a problem with, you say dak dak dak, and we say duck duck duck." And anyone south of Watford in my bringing up was, "Ooh, suspect he's a Southern spiff." So I said, "You've a double thing to twist there." But I genuinely believe, using a very common phrase that he uses, what's Robbie's phrase that he uses?
Cool.
No.
Oh, rationale.
Rationale. Now the chairman's one. The chairman's one is, "Alf, I don't want to blow smoke up your backside, but you're doing a good job." I could go on for a long time, but I've one or two other things to do as well. And a very, very special gentleman, which will emphasise even further what this club means to people at both ends of the spectrum. You saw a couple of weeks ago, TNA did a wonderful piece after that, our eventual relegation at Huddersfield. They quoted quite a number of people, supporters, "We're still with the Bulls, whatever happens." Wonderful. And then it showed a youngster, little Harry Smith. And we said, we gave our press officer, who's a grand lad, Ryan, we gave him 2 hours to find this youngster, because we are going to turn his tears into a smile. I also said, the young fella, he's not so young now, used to work for me at Leeds. And if I gave him a task like that, he'd have turned it around within half an hour. Duffy. Again, a good one. One of the best. So we got him down. And obviously, Jimmy and the players made his day last Sunday. And a terrific thing. And I think that says a lot for this club. And it emphasises even more, we're asking you to come and listen to us and let us talk to you, because we're talking to you because you're here to see the players. There, I disagree slightly with what Mark was saying, they're the stars of our game. Make no mistake, they're the ones who you want to meet. we forget that you come to the match and watch them, you go home. We don't know who you are. That'll change under these lot, I can tell you. We will know. You're going home tonight. I would ask you to behave and expect calls, not asking you to, have you had your loft converted, have you had whatever, all the calls we get, but you'll get the Bradford Bulls sales team, telesales team on to check that you enjoyed the evening and put your hand in your pocket. Oh, I shouldn't have said that, should I? No. It's important that what we're doing, the club has turned. I mean, I came here end of April and not been to Oddsall for a long time. And as I say, how some of the staff were working it, we've gone through the players being treated abominably and people leaving because they weren't being paid. And quite rightly, that fella broke all the promises and let them go. But the staff too, who perform miracles in keeping this club going. Who's got a phone going when I'm speaking? And they deserve to be applauded because when they talk to the way they were, full mark. I never was a fighter, but this week the gloves were off and two of the girls nearly downed me. Robbie came to my rescue. Because sometime you have to introduce a little bit of Timpson into the thing. Now Timpson means a bit of that. Old fashioned kick. They've been brilliant, not since the bit of Timpson, let me say. They have been absolutely superb in how they've rallied to the cause. I'm absolutely certain they had a little bit of doubt that this evening would be as successful as it is. I didn't doubt it for 1 minute. We could have done this for 40 years, whether it's at Batley, whether it's at Carlisle, whether it's at Keith in Scotland, whether it was at Southampton in the south of England, Wimbledon. Yes, there is a strong saying he's been to more clubs than Jack Nicklaus. I genuinely have. I've done them all. And it gives me a warmth when I can come into a room like this and be amongst people and reminisce with people like John Aymer. I said to him when I saw him, I said, you give me some bloody unhappy times here when I was with Leeds. But notwithstanding that, there's a wonderful camaraderie in our game. And this club is on the way forward. Marc Green has done the first in saving the club and proving to me that I think he's here for the long haul. Now what we need, whatever he does, if we don't harness ourselves behind him, we'll struggle to succeed. My first job in any club I've ever been to is to get the foundation right. The same in the house. If we have a house, get the foundations right, it's unlikely to fall down. When he asked me to come and help devise a strategy, I did what I've done at Leeds and Bolton, wherever. Get that base right. And the base starts with every one of us in this room by paying into the big one, £1 a week, give us 52 up front, 26 half a year, 13, whatever, or stand in order through the bank. Please, I can tell you now, we've taken another. Well, he said he was a legend. I do basically remember. Do you remember Carl Pratt? Yeah. Come here, Pratty. Pratt is your man. I've advised him on the way I've achieved reasonable success is to get amongst people like you. Yes, I've done deal with Tetley's and done a 2.3 million deal and similar with Bass and enjoyed it and done it well and it's nice. But I've equally always been able to engage with people who I'm asking for a pound to keep that base solid. If the base is solid, the other strategies that these guys have got planned will really make a difference. So what I'm saying tonight, and I've lost my papers already, I'm urging all of you to put your name, signature, your telephone number on your piece of paper there. If you've already done it, we'll find you. If you've not done it, please do it now. And we have a final check on this, because all the entrances that way are closed, so you go there. And when you go down there, I've heard it said that Carl Fairbanks at the back door, Brendan Hill's around the corner, and if you've not signed, you're being knocked back in. So again, introducing Pratty, he's your man to get the big one bouncing, and Carl, with the, along with the ladies who suffered abysmally under that dreadful person, they're on board and doing a wonderful job. The other girls in the office who have equally been treated badly, they're on board and firing under Robbie. And I do think this club has a great future. But please. Oh, no. You know what he said? He says, you forgot something. I said, no, I never forget. I'm old, but I don't forget. I never admit to it. I said, this night would be brilliant. And if it is, it's me. If it had been crap, it was Robbie. And again, on a final note from me, you've no right leaving without my permission. I think he'll have a great career with the club. With you, if he harnesses your support, as I advise him he should, he's no danger that he'll go on to bigger and better things and prove a great asset to Robbie and the board. But another thing we're good at here at Bradford, in rugby league, but Bradford particularly, we've talked about little Harry Smith. Harry Smith, yes. Wonderful. To see those tears and then see the smile, great. But now I've got to be careful, because at my age, to get off this stage could be a problem. But I'd like to... Oh! I tell you what, even as old as I am, you never lose your pace, do you? There's a gentleman here I met the other week, and we had a good chat. Charlie Ebbage. We've talked a lot about legends. Every club in the game has a Charlie Ebbage. Some of them, unfortunately, don't recognise it. Bradford recognised Charlie, and he has, before I invite him up to a little presentation with the chairman, or Robbie, have I got that right, the chairman, I'd like to say something else. I did a job at St. Helens. They had a Charlie Ebbage. He was called George. And he went to collect the lottery every week, and he brought about 25 grand a year in. At the time, Saints were looking to do a shirt sponsorship with St. Helens Glass. Do you remember St. Helens Glass on the Saints shirt? And they were looking around how they were going to get the money, and for that money they got 20 tickets in the box there and 20 meals and whatever. I said, you've got somebody now who brings you 25 grand a year in. Who? Harry Cashton, good friend of mine, God rest him. Who? Who's that of? I said, George. I said, he has a BSA motorbike or whatever. It was old. He went round the streets of St. Helens and he brought 25 grand a year in for that club. He got a complimentary ticket for each match and his commission. So I said, he should be at every function at this club because he's more important than your biggest sponsor, or equally as important. So he invited him down to the launch. Now, George lived on his own. He didn't always smell as nice as he ought to. But he was the life and soul of that club. And the point I'm coming to, the directors didn't know he existed. And they went to St. Helens Glass and whatever. And I said to George, after introducing him, Harry was great with him, Harry Cashton, once he knew. Are you comfortable, George? You don't look too happy. He said, I'm not, Alf. I said, what would you like? He said, a tracksuit. Now, Charlie Ebbage, George at St. Helens, whoever else, we all have them. We're ignorant if we ignore people like yourselves and Charlie, because without the Charlies, without the little Harry Smith, we're going nowhere. And I've said to Marc and to Danny, don't need to tell Robbie because he knows everything, doesn't he? That it's not just once a year you should be invited here. They want to know how things are going, have a function regularly, but down at the ground. will learn a lot more by talking to you. They will learn a lot more. And their plans for the future with launching all the new initiatives that you see unveiled in front of you, ahead of the team marching out to the championship. I tell you what, if you can take a crowd like this to Lee and to all these other grounds, you'll frighten them to death. Thanks for listening to you. Final repeat. Robbie's going to sound it off, but I'm having a say too. Please fill that form in. Get behind the big one. And let's post. Pratty's on a target. He's got to get to 2,500 by the 17th of August when the first draw is. He's at 1,569 now. We all go out from here and sign that form. We're well on the way. And we really will underpin everything this club's trying to build to get the Bulls back where they should be, up there. Thanks for listening to me. Please, if you could just spare me time, Charlie. Wonderful. Your memories of this club going back to the 30s and so on. Did Steve Ferres play then? Yes.
Oh, he said yes.
Charlie, can I ask you to come to the stage with me, please? The chairman would like to show his true recognition and what we should do to a wonderful old gentleman who supports Bradford through thick and thin.
Apart from players and staff, the first actual supporter of this club I actually met, having taken over by coincidence, was Charlie. So it gives me great pleasure to officially make you a life member of the club. Something I promised you when I actually met you. Again, a promise. And I look forward to seeing you at the game for many, many years to come. The mic.
And he's got a tale about me.
Yeah, I have. I remember the first match you played, do you remember, at York in the A team? And me and Arnie are putting the kit in the bus, and the polite little voice says, "Where's the bus?" And Arnie being an old Yorkshireman, he said, "Nay, lad, they don't talk like that now, aren't they?" At a Yorkshire. And then one day I was coming up after Brian Smith had given him a talk, and Robbie said to me, "I do." But we cracked it.
I told you it didn't take me long. I'll do. Ladies and gentlemen, please be upstanding again. Charlie Ebbage. Sit down. So like we say, if the team and the boys are at the heart of what our club is, then it truly is, you guys are the lifeblood that keeps it pumping. That keeps it pumping. Because without you guys, there's no professional sports. There's no reason for it. There's no sport full stop. You guys are that lifeblood. You're absolutely that lifeblood. Okay, now you guys don't need to move. What we're going to do now is the boys are going to come to the table with a member of staff, and we're going to get you all signed up, because we're in this together, aren't we? We're in this together, aren't we? Every single staff member at the Bulls, including myself, are playing in this. I've never won it. Jimmy's won it twice, I think. Never the 5,000, but he's won it twice at least. £500 of that. I was gutted when he won it as well, back when we were playing. John Hamer's mum's won it twice. So everybody stay seated. Boys, get out there now. Please be patient. We're going to get to your tables. We're going to do the raffle draw right at the end. Yep, no worries. You can finish off, sir. And just probably the most important marketing tool of all time is that when the players come around, they're going to bring these little pamphlets with them. You guys are our best tools. We need you guys to go home and get your friends and family involved as well. If you guys can do that for us, then you can just imagine how big. Everybody sat here, if they got five people, there's 500 people in this room. You can just imagine the statistics. All right, before I finish off, I'm going to hand over to the chairman just to finish off.
I've just had my shins kicked under the table. While the players are walking around, just because I forgot to mention two things, and I apologise for doing so. First of all, I forgot to mention a new sponsor that the club has secured, which is Tetley's. Which is down to our commercial director, Danny. They've come on board on a 3-year deal. So even though we've been relegated, we have a main sponsor now with Tetley Breweries. And the other thing I forgot to mention was, I got an email off someone this week saying to me, please don't forget to mention Bull Power. I switched my energy online using Bradford Bull's website and I've saved £144 on my electricity and gas bill this year. For those of you who haven't actually logged on to it, Bull Power is available on the website. It's a genuine comparison website and it is 100% of our customers that have used it have saved money and in doing so generated £12 for the club. It's not a lot, but if 10,000 people switched at £12 a go, that's quite a lot of money. Thank you.
Hey, and the best job of the night, you can eat your chocolate bars. They've already gone.